is up on you to verify. Anyway, I'm not going to talk about Java that much today. I'd like to talk about languages running on top of JVM. So I have a few slides, but we should probably skip them because they are not that important. I started as a NetBeans founder and designed architecture of NetBeans, made so many mistakes that I was hired into Oracle Labs to help them design API for Graal and Truffle. Yeah, vision is great. Vision, yes, we believe we can deliver real products. This is a statement of my boss about what the compiler is. This is the architecture. This is the important part, talking about Truffle. It's a way, basically a way how to write a languages, interpreters for dynamic languages, and make them fast. And we believe we can make them fast and make it easy for any one of you to write such languages. Some description of languages, yeah. Some languages are slow, but we would like to make them as fast as is the goal. So something like 5 times slower than the fastest one. And it may seem that currently on Java VM you can do things like that, but usually only if the language looks like Java or C sharp. So this is how we do it. I skip that. We don't need to know that. And this is the important slide. I'm from Oracle. So in case you decide you like my presentation and decide to buy Oracle stocks, you are doing that on your own risk. Because, yeah, maybe that's all a fake. And now we are back to demos. Or we can start the demos. Perfect. So who speaks Ruby? Anyone? Nobody speaks Ruby. That's perfect. I don't speak Ruby either. But this is my first program in Ruby. And actually, when I joined Oracle Labs, they told me, yeah, we can run Ruby 10 times faster than anyone else. And I was thinking, yeah, maybe you can on some strange benchmark. But I want to see how fast you are in real program. So this is my real program. It's Sieve of Eratosthenes. This part generates natural numbers from 2 to infinity. This is a filter that keeps linked list of all prime numbers and filters them. And if none of the prime numbers divides the one that we are, the number that we are checking, then it's a prime number. Okay, and then here is the main loop. It takes the first number from that infinite list. If it's divisible by the by some prime number, then it's not accepted. Otherwise, it's added into the filter, and we continue. And here is the main loop. We try to compute 100,000 prime numbers and measure the time how long it takes. And we repeat the computation because, well, what Graal does, what is the purpose of what we do, is to optimize for long-running processes, like processes running on a server. So anyway, I have a Ruby implementation on my computer, and I can run the program. And it starts fast, and at the end, it also computes something. This time, it took 3.5 seconds. Second time as well, third time as well, basically. So 3.5 seconds to compute this program. So now it's time to introduce you GraalVM. GraalVM is a Java virtual machine. So if we look at the content, maybe find is probably too verbose. LSL, it looks like Java machine layout. But in the bin, you can find all the Java tools, of course. But there are also tools like Ruby. And you can use them to execute Ruby. So if we use the GraalVM to run the same program, then actually the startup time is not that fantastic. And also the first iteration may take slightly longer because we are interpreting the system. But at the but after a while, the whole code warms up and the JIT compiler kicks in, and actually is capable to run the same computation in like 150 milliseconds. So really, in this case, we are something like 10 times, maybe even more, faster. So now, of course, these days, people don't write programs in Ruby anymore. These days, everyone writes programs in JavaScript, right? Do you write programs in JavaScript? Anyone? Don't be ashamed. Some people really do. Yeah, and the number of them is growing because they believe JavaScript is so portable and beautiful language. So I tried that, and I actually decided to rewrite this program into JavaScript. So JS, Sieve.js. So here is the version in JavaScript, and again, generator of natural numbers, filter. Yes, bigger font. That's good idea. That's good idea. Okay? So, well, I know you all know how to compute sieve of Eratosthenes, how to compute primes. So basically, the algorithm is the same as in Ruby. And again, it repeats the computation up to 100,000 times and prints the time it takes to run this program. So, of course, the fastest JavaScript implementation is Node, or V8 by Google, which is included in Node. So let's try to run it in Node. Starts fast, runs fast, but if you look at it, at least in this application, it is even slightly slower than the Ruby one. But anyway, we also provide a way to run JavaScript code. So let's do it. Inside of the Graal VM, there is a script called JS. So let's use it. And again, the first iteration is not that fast. But when things optimize, we actually get to 95 milliseconds. So does that mean that we should rewrite all our programs into JavaScript? No, of course not. We want to rewrite just the critical parts in JavaScript. So here is my attempt to do so. I'll make the font bigger. Okay. So this is the Ruby part. So the generator of natural numbers is still written in Ruby. But the filtering is written in JavaScript. I think that's this code. Yes. So it does not, it does not contain the natural number generator. And here, at the end of the program, we are actually using some interoperability API. When the Ruby implementation takes this method and exports it so other languages can find it and use it. So in JavaScript, we actually use the import part. So the symbol exported by Ruby gets imported here. So the natural is actually an object coming from Ruby, used in JavaScript. And here somewhere, yes, on this line, when we call natural next, we are actually making call into a different language. And if you know how problematic is to bridge different languages, you usually suffer a lot because you need to convert the internal data structures. You need to somehow switch from one interpreter to another interpreter and make a call, put something on a stack, and that, of course, slows everything down. So now we hope we won't see that effect with GraalVM. Of course, I cannot use any other system because there is no other system that could run Ruby and JavaScript at full speed. So let's do it like this. GraalVM comes with a script called GraalVM. And as parameter of the GraalVM script, you can specify as many scripts as you want. So first of all, I will run the Ruby script, this one. And then I will run the JavaScript, which does the computation, imports the symbol, and does the computation. So as far as the initial startup goes, we are concatenating the startup time of our Truffle Ruby implementation and our JavaScript implementation, and that's not completely fast. But, well, then, if the system warms up and runs at full speed, we basically see that we can achieve a similar result to our pure JavaScript version in this system where we mix Ruby and mix JavaScript. So what does it mean? We don't have to rewrite all our code into JavaScript. We can keep it in the languages that it was written in. Of course, we are at Java conference, so I assume that some of you code Java. Yeah. So the question is, can we actually take this and use it from inside of Java? So here is an example of the API, how you can do it. Okay. Yes, so that's the main method. So basically here is a Java code which sets up something we call Polyglot Engine. Polyglot Engine is basically an execution environment for all languages that we support. Then this kind of script finds the source files, and we create a Ruby source and Java source. And then we execute Ruby source, and we execute Java source. So this is basically exactly what we did from the command line. The GraalVM launcher basically does the same thing. So it sets up the Polyglot engine, and once it's ready, it executes the Ruby and executes the JavaScript. And as you can see, the result is the same. So basically, from your Java code, you can get access to all these scripting languages that are running at, we'd say, full speed. So this is the result, 93. Of course, it varies from time to time. So now, that's not all. So basically, one of the propositions that I'm trying to make is, if you want to implement your own language, then use Truffle APIs. Because with the Truffle APIs, you just implement interpreter for your language, and we will take care of making that fast. Now, the thing is, we not only make your language fast, we give you tools for free. And one of the tools is debugger. Actually, running a debugger is, or writing a debugger, is really painful process. Not many people want to do it. I implemented few VMs, and none of them has a debugger because it's so boring to write it. But actually here, the Graal can help you. If we just start oh, that was profiler. No, we don't profile. We want to profile. That's not working yet. If we start debugger, then basically we can debug the Java program, and we hit the breakpoint just before the JavaScript is being evaluated. So, here we are, okay. And I will step into. So now, basically, the Graal language is initializing itself, and actually, the NetBeans debugger with small hook for understanding Truffle APIs can find out that we are in JavaScript, and can even show the stack trace to really look like tailored for the JavaScript. And we can step over, and if we put there a breakpoint, like in this case, I hope I can continue. And now I'm at the call for natural next. And if you remember, what happened before is we got the natural object from the Ruby side. So I will press step into, and we are in a Ruby code. So now, if you look at the Ruby code, the IDE does not even know how to syntax color it. So the IDE doesn't know anything about the Ruby debugger. But because it's all written on top of Truffle, we basically, or the IDE basically can understand the language, even it doesn't know what the what's the language syntax. So if I step over, we can see that we see variables, we see structure of this object, and so on, so on. So basically, not only Truffle gives people speed, but also gives you free tooling. In the comment is in NetBeans. Actually, NetBeans was the first IDE that implemented cross-language debugging between Java and JavaScript and NASHorn. And when we released it, we were relatively proud of it. After 3 months, the same support appeared in IntelliJ. So I'm quite sure that they can copy this support as well. OK, so now, if you have questions, you can ask. What is the availability and license of Truffle and Graal? Okay. Need to move it. So what I usually do, I go to Google and type OTN, which is Oracle Technology Network, Graal. And this gives me a list of links that lead to OTN website of Oracle. Where is some description of what it does, but download is more important. Here you accept the license, and you can download it. So that's the easiest way how to get a binary that basically can do all that I just demonstrated. Of course, the other question is like real licensing, whether you can get access to source code. And yes. So, so first of all, licensing. The project is hosted on GitHub. So this is GitHub/GraalVM. And here you can see Graal Core, which is basically the compiler, Truffle, which is the API, and some languages. Truffle, JRuby Truffle, that's what we work on or contribute to. FastR, which is a re-implementation of R language. And also the other thing that is relatively important is Sulong, which is an interpreter of LLVM bitcode. So basically every language that compiles to LLVM bitcode can be run by Truffle as well, and almost at full speed, let's say. So, and licenses, I don't know what's that. It's GPL with ClassPath exception. So it should be relatively usable. Similar commercial license like what?
Like the
Java Flash Recorder. Flight recorder? Oh, no, I don't think so. So the thing with Graal is that it's still Oracle Labs project, and it has not made it into official Oracle offering. So if you want to pay dollars to Oracle to use Graal, you have no chance right now. What we offer is to these open source repositories, and we offer the binary download. And the binary download contains some additional stuff to make it even faster. But like that's all. We don't have any other product that we would be included in. Interesting question is JDK 9. For JDK 9, we actually, Right now, if you want to download Graal, you actually need to download the whole JVM. So that's this is called GraalVM, and it basically gives you the whole image as I demonstrated it. But of course, people don't want to download everything; they already have their JDK installed. So what we are doing with JDK 9 will contain JVM CI interface, which is Java Virtual Machine Compiler interface, and this allows you to download Graal, put it on a class path, and it will be immediately be used for the compilation. Probably one thing that I have not mentioned is that the difference between the current Hotspot C2 compiler and Graal is that the Graal compiler is written in Java. So it's all Java code, and you just need a jar file to turn it on. Another question? Is the warm-up time fixable?
Yeah.
I certainly hope so. One thing, so for us, the project went through a few stages. One stage was, so you are writing a compiler that will compete with Hotspot C2, you have no chance. You never will be as fast as C2. And we believe we are on par. The other thing was, so you are writing a generic interpreter framework that will work for every languages, and you want to compete with V8, which is specially tailored to support JavaScript, you have no chance. And actually we have. Right now, we are on par or even faster. So the next step that people complain about is completeness. So you, it's fine you have your implementation of your language, but I want basically run every Ruby program on top of it. I want to run every Node.js program on top of it. And that's what we are addressing currently. And the next thing that we people complain about is the startup time. So I believe we can address that as well. The first idea that I have is to speed up the parsing. So basically right now we parse everything and create eagerly the structure for the whole source, which slows things down. The other problem is that the Ruby implementation is actually written in Ruby. So first of all, we need to basically warm up Ruby to run Ruby, and that slows things down as well. That's the reason why Ruby is so slow. And but I believe that's fixable as well, like initialization on demand, where you really parse only the subsystem that you need, should help with that a lot. So that's not unsolvable problem. And then the next thing is that part of Oracle Labs is working on something which is called Substrate VM, which is actually like smallest VM. It's not based on Hotspot. It's completely re-implementation, but small VM. And it actually does ahead of time compilation. And the experiment that we did is that Ruby, even in current state of things, start like this on Substrate VM. So we believe we have solution. Which one we will choose, I'm not completely sure. But even right now, we can internally, because Substrate VM is not open source, internally start Ruby with this system in few milliseconds. So I probably should also talk about Java. So here is Sieve of Eratosthenes written in Java. So I do Maven project, Maven, Java, algorithm, pom.xml, package, exec, Java. So do you remember the times of the other languages, like JavaScript, Ruby, and so on? So Java is fast, it starts fast, but when you look at the result, like it's 90 milliseconds. So there's no reason not to code in JavaScript, guys. It's the same, it can execute at the same speed as Java. But this command has been executed on top of Hotspot. So this is the classical Hotspot result. But I can also execute it on GraalVM. And yeah, it should be at least as fast as the previous result, but in many cases, actually, it's faster. So the Graal VM can actually run this code. Yeah, I should probably show it, right? NB Java algorithm. So that's basically the re-implementation of the Sieve of Eratosthenes into Java. It contains the natural number generator, it contains the filter, and the main method, the primes, that do the computation, basically. So the same structure of the program, and your classical hotspot that you are using these days is as fast as JavaScript. But Java can do better. If you download GraalVM and run Java on GraalVM, it actually runs at least 10% faster in this case. Your experience may vary. One guy, my very good friend, once said something like, and what if we rewrite this into C? So actually, yes, I also decided to rewrite this program into C. Oops, opening projects. Yes, that will probably take a time because we need to activate the C++ support. As you can see, I'm not using C++ that often. So here is the implementation. Main C, and again, natural numbers generator, filter. The thing which is new is actually release filter, because of course C does not have garbage collector. And then otherwise the structure is the same. So let's run it. And that's the fastest time. Wow. It's so slow. Then actually, usually I show first the debug configuration, which is of course slower than Java, but even the release one is now slow. That's not fair. 89. It's still faster. Okay. So Graal is faster than C. That surprises me slightly. That's the first time I see this result, but yeah, maybe that can happen. Question? The output certainly slows the program slightly, but the difference is not that huge. Basically, I'm computing 100,000 of prime numbers, and in between of them, I'm printing 10 lines. So the influence is not that huge. I believe in the Java case, I probably did it. But okay, so the thing is, if you want to I was just complaining before this session started that all those performance guys claiming how they are great in implementing some technology and pretend that they do science are actually doing only cargo science, because often the results are unverifiable. Like, find out how they got their results. Every paper ends with a huge table and graphs showing how the speed is great, but nobody ever saw the code, just a text in the paper, and that's a cargo science in my opinion. So this is not completely this is not a science, and definitely this is not cargo science. If you want, here is the source code that I'm showing. So it's on GitHub, yotulach/sieve, and well, you can try it yourself. You can even suppress the output, and it makes it slightly faster, but it does not have significant effect, probably. Okay, so now, is there anyone using Node.js around? One. Thank you, Tony. I was expecting Nick as well, but Nick is probably tired somewhere. Anyway, of course, when we have so fast application, so fast execution engine for running JavaScript, why not run Node.js, which is the flagship program for JavaScript on a server? So if I go into NetBeans, choose HTML5 JavaScript, and I want to create new application. So let me do it. So this should create new JavaScript application, and what I can do here is print I can run it, and as you can see, it actually uses Node, which is part of the release 0.13 of GraalVM, and it prints hello jcrete. This should if you knew Node by heart, this should give you already a hint that this is not the real implementation of Node, because there is no print in Node. The print is only in Java, JavaScript engines like Nashorn or Truffle.js. But what I can do also is to use the classical thing for accessing Java classes. So Java type, Java lang, long, parse long, 555, var x, and hello jcreate with x. So I can run it, and we should see some result. And this result is obtained from a cooperation between JavaScript and Java Virtual Machine. And now, of course, you don't have to believe me, but let me put a breakpoint here. Okay? So I start this Node application in a debugger, in actually a Java debugger. And now, here is a call into the Java type. I think I need to place a bookmark there. What long? Okay, breakpoint there. Okay, let me parse long. Okay, this is it. So I will put breakpoint here, and I will step over. And
make the font a little bigger.
I'm sorry. Yeah, but certainly right now you can see that we are inside of Java. So really, that's a Node.js implementation running on top of Java Virtual Machine. So in case you want to mix server-side JavaScript with Java and with any other language like Ruby or R, well, you have an environment to do so, which is GraalVM. Questions? None? There is one. Perfect. Does this support tail call optimization? Perfect question. Let's look at how the code is organized. So I will not show you the JavaScript implementation because I don't understand it. But I should be able, actually, how do I do it? Like this, cd, oops, nb, truffle.com. So I will open the projects inside of NetBeans. The NetBeans support is so poor. Manage platforms, add platform, standard edition. Hopefully, maybe that doesn't matter. So, tail core optimizations. SL return node. So we have a language which we use for testing purposes. Oh, no, I need to fix the problems first. Resolve, manage platforms, add platform. So, background scanning of projects, perfect. SL return. Okay, return exception. That's fine. Seems more or less okay. Return node. Okay. So the thing that we do in when you want to write your own implementation of a language, fonts. Okay. So when you want to write your own implementation of your language, you write an interpreter. And the basic element which appears in every language is a representation of a callable unit, usually a function. So for function, the Truffle API defines something called root node. So here, this SL language, the simple language, is this defining its own subclass called SL root node. And the SL root node primary method is execute. So whenever somebody calls your function, this is the way, this is the method that will be called, and you can start interpreting. And usually, by interpreting something, you look to left, you look to right, you compute the result on left, compute the result on right, and then you do something with that. So for example, I think SL add node is showing how these things are done. So basically, it is a binary node, so it has left and right, and then when the left and right arrives, it actually computes the result, which means concatenating, summing the numbers. So that's how you write interpreter. Of course, if you want to write interpreter, for example, for a while cycle, then you create a node for representing the while. And inside of that, you have some other nodes doing the operations of your language. But often, many languages offer you to return back from inside of a loop. And that's exactly the moment when you need to go up, pop up the stack for the actual operation, for the while node operation, and if statement, if there is something like that, and really pop up from the method. And this is done by exceptions. So here, the return node is actually representing the return statement somewhere in your method body. And what it does, it throws an exception. And this exception is caught somewhere. Actually, it's caught in SL function body node. So the exception pops up the stack. And then it just directly returns from the method to the caller. And this is actually a way how you can simulate tail calls. If you detect that there is a tail call somewhere in your function, you first of all throw an exception, which will unwind the stack, and then call the actual method. So it's, I think JavaScript implementation is using it. This SL function one or SL language one does not. But it's similar concept like the return.
So it's like trampolining inside the interpreter.
It is, I didn't get the word.
It's like a trampolining interpreter?
Trampolining in the interpreter, yes. That's probably a nice way to describe it. Okay, a question?
So what happens to the garbage collector when you're creating a shitload of objects? I guess they will eventually be not collected, but it will be optimized too.
So what happens to the garbage collector? Depends.
You're defining your language in Java.
Yes.
Creating objects on the heap.
So basically, all these nodes are representation of your program. And it has to stay on the heap if needed. So actually, we can do lazy parsing, which is one way how to, for example, speed up the execution of the JavaScript. Really parse only lazily. But once you parse it and the code is being executed, it needs to stay on the heap. So yes, the code basically becomes part of the heap. Quite a lot. Yeah, so the memory consumption, so for node application, it turned out that in current state, it needs 4 gigabytes of memory to run. But it's
more interested in the number of objects, not the size. I don't care about the size.
yeah, so.
Garbage collectors never have problem with size, they have problem with the number of objects.
Mm-hmm.
So
basically what GraalVM does is it takes, currently the build looks like, we take the most recent JDK 8 and we recompile some native glue, which is the JVM CI for Java 8, and then we add some libraries. So it's typical JDK 8 or 9, depends, but the download is for 8. And so garbage collector is exactly the same.
Okay.
And okay, question. In case of C language,
yes.
The, okay. Let's try. Let's try. So, so the question was how Truffle deals with C language. Let's. I give you a demo, and hopefully that may answer your question. It also may not. So CD Sulong. So long. So the thing is, okay, so we have a project called So Long. I already mentioned it, and I need to find it once again, because it contains helpful readme, which I need to copy. Okay, so this is basically for implementing LLVM bytecode. So the thing to start is here, MX. MX is our build tool, just ignore it. Take emit LLVM bytecode for output this file for test file. So this is what I'm going to do. Sieve.ll, I have it here, but let's do it once again. Sieve main. Okay, so now basically what we should get is a recompilation of my sieve of Erasto.ns written in C into LLVM bytecode. So this is the output of the clunk compiler. And now I can feed this output into suran, mx suran into graal. So I will use sieve.ll. Okay, so now basically graal will interpret the C. Program somehow. Yeah, somehow. Well, it's really interpreter because you can see that the start is not that perfect. But when it runs, 100 something milliseconds, so it's something like 10% slower than, 10 to 20% slower than the optimized C usually. And this is very useful for having extensions for dynamic languages. So all of the languages usually deal with C somehow to get access to native or to get access to operating system. And in this case, we basically and the problem is that when you are going from the interpreted mode to the C code, you need to somehow transfer the the data structures and also make a call on a stack, which slows things down. And we hope that by using this Truffle C interpreter, or the Sulong, we basically can avoid that. And actually, the Graal compiler will be then able to optimize everything as a one chunk, which probably leads me to a few slides that I skipped at the beginning, which explain how that works. So this is the most complicated, this A plus B is the most complicated expression you can find in dynamic languages. And the reason for that is that when you parse the code, you have no idea whether A is integer, string, or object, and what type B is. So the thing how we deal with that is that when we parse the source code, we actually create the nodes in so-called uninitialized state. That's on the left there. Yeah, somewhere here. So that's a representation of structure of your source code. But then, in addition to this, every language can define a transaction table that can turn the nodes into a different state. So in case, when executing the plus operation, you find out that actually the type is integer, you colorify your node to be ready for integers. If then arises a double, you turn into double state. If there is a string, you turn into the green state. And if there is so many different types, then you turn into generic state. And of course, the generic state is slow because the interpreter needs to do something like, if this is integer, do this. If this is double, do something else. If this is string, do something else. While that is inherently slow in the generated code. While if you only know that the data floating through this position in your program are only integers, you can actually create more optimized code. And the observation that we have made is that usually when you type a plus somewhere in your programs, the arguments are likely to be fixed. It's not going to be like sometimes it's string, sometimes it's integer. Usually the arguments there are always the same. So what we do, after a bit of interpreting, we colorify the graph. So the nodes get into some state, ready for integers, ready for the generic case. And then when Graal compiler kicks in, it actually compiles an effective code ready for the actual data types that are in used in your program. Of course, what may happen is that from time to time, the assumptions are wrong and we need to de-optimize the code. So instead of using this, so what we do, we need to throw away the native code, the generated native code. We switch back into the interpreter mode and we let the interpreter recolorize the graph. So instead of the integer nodes, it can somewhere put double nodes ready for doubles. And if this part of the program is still hot, we will recompile it again. This time slightly less efficient, but still as efficient as possible with respect to the data that are being currently used in the program. Question?
In the compilation you do, in C you can use switches to optimize the compilation. The comparison is based on the standard compilation setup. But I mean, you can enable switches for the ordering and doing
so I
stuff on the low level.
I understand the topic. So in C, we can use switches to like choose between the cases. But it's not fast, right? If you can prove direct before and even entering the method that the type will always be one of those cases, you can optimize the code and throw away the switch completely. And that will make it faster. Here is an example how this works in the SL language. So here is implementation of the add node. So the add node is a binary node. It has left and right. But then it comes with a specialization. It basically says, OK, if the left argument is of type long and right argument is of type long as well, then let's use this method to concatenate them. But of course, if you add left and like long, you can get an overflow exception. And that's actually what this method does. And this annotation says, OK, in case you get arithmetic exception, then please de-optimize and interpret again and rewrite so you can handle the case when the numbers get bigger. And this is the other option. There is another specialization for different data types. So the SL language is using basically long, string, and big integer to represent arbitrary precision numbers. So in case we cannot fit into long and the data that are flowing through are big integer, we use this method and do the addition using big integer Java class. If it's string with some guards here, we do the string concatenation. And basically, by using these annotations, the system, the Truffle API, and then, of course, with cooperation with the Graal, can guarantee you that the code will do the coloring of the graph automatically, that it will really select the right specialization for each node that you have in the graph. And that will result into the as fast execution of your program as possible. What kind of data types?
Half precision float.
Yes. So actually, you can define any data types you want. The language internally can use any structures. For example, Ruby is using some big integer. It's called fixNum in the Ruby language. And it's mostly big integer, but not completely. It has some different semantic, so they really have their own implementation of big integer, and they can do anything with it, and it still optimizes quite well.
The second question would be, I can probably operate a little bit with that amount of language. I guess I can use the operator for pretty much everything I want to, as long as I have specialization.
So you can use operator overloading. Yes, you can basically, well, it's your decision to do what you want. If instead of adding, okay, so here we are adding two longs, and we do add, and if I decide that in big integer I want to do remove, divide, I want to divide, you can do divide, which is operator overloading, and that's it. Yes, you well you are doing the interpreter of your language, whatever the semantic is. We just want to make sure that you can express it in Java and express it in some optimal way, and it's up to you to find the semantics. For example, I know that the R language is when you invoke plus, it actually does a lookup of what plus means through chain of contexts. And while doing the lookup, it can actually redefine, for example, definition of multiply. So if you have plus times something, just by resolving the lookup for plus, you can redefine the meaning of multiply. So all these tricks are possible, and Graal can make them effective. Okay, so the question is, in this example, with when I was executing Ruby and JavaScript from Java, here is it. So does this have to run on Graal VM, or like only this part needs to run on Graal VM? Technically, only this part, but the only thing you can do is to probably launch a separate process and run the programs in there. Otherwise, if you want to run it in one VM, it has to be Graal VM.
Okay.
Or in case of JDK 9, it has to be official JDK 9 with the Graal VM jar registered as a compiler. Tony. Java still rules. We want to code in Java.
But as you mentioned, JavaScript is much more portable right now. It didn't used to be the case, but it's more portable, and you can run it on totally different platforms, like for example in the browser. So you cannot do that with C for us, basically.
Well, that's a good comment. Basically, Java lost its right once run anywhere. No, these days it's JavaScript. You write it once and it runs anywhere. Does it mean we have to rewrite everything into JavaScript? Well, Tony, no, we don't have to. I have a solution for you. It's based on UkeScript, of course. Thanks for such a question showing the right direction of the talk. Yes. So, let's switch to the console. So the first thing that people say is that, okay, it's fine that we can run Java fast, but we would like to actually run Java in a browser. And I think I have a solution for that. So here, and without Java plugin, because yeah, I believe the future of Java plugin is not that bright. Yeah. So if you remember, here was the algorithm for the sieve of Eratosthenes written in Java, which I can still execute like this. So it's a Maven project, and it computes the sieve. But next to it, I have a yes. Next to it, there is a client project, and this actually has been generated by Tonis Duke script. So, okay, that's a mistake. Exec. So now, basically, we'll use the same code, just instead of printing to command line, there is a wrapper that shows a browser and shows the result in a browser. And of course, it's slightly slower, but that's probably because of the rendering things. Of course, Tony knows that this is not real browser. This is a web component. So what you actually can do with this is like use Graal VM or use Hotspot VM to actually render from Java into HTML. There's no JavaScript whatsoever in this example, at least not visible in the code. But what we have is client web, which is another project, and it is using Java bytecode to JavaScript transpiler. It's not ASM.js. ASM.js doesn't have much to do with Java. There are two virtual machines, one that run Java bytecode in browser. One is back to browser VM, that's written by me in my spare time. And second one is TVM. So this one is running TVM. And as you can see, the results are not that horrible. So basically, yes, Tony, you can continue to use Java and run it even in a browser, because Duke script makes things portable. And actually, the V8 engines or the JavaScript engine are really fast. So the performance degradation is not that huge, almost invisible.
Thank you.
You're welcome. So, three last minutes. Questions? Perfect. Graal seems good for dynamic languages, but what if I'm not implementing dynamic language? So if you are implementing a statically typed language, then the Sulong is your answer. Basically, use the LLVM chain, and then you will get the LLVM bitcode, and Sulong helps you to execute it. But there is more to it. Actually, if you look at how the structure of, I don't know, for example, the SL root node looks like, it's real Java. And this kind of Java cannot, well, if you run this on normal hotspot, it's not going to be fast. But Graal can make it fast, and there are no tricks. Actually, Graal can make fast any Java program. So if you are writing a Java program and you adhere to certain style of writing it, you can gain speed in your program, and the speed will be enormous compared to hotspot. So basically, the thing is, even if you don't have your own language and you implement a root node and you register it properly in the system, the speed up of your Java programs can be enormous. But because we are out of time, I probably cannot demonstrate it. And the other reason is that I don't have the demo ready. But if there is an interest, I can do a Hackergarten about that and basically show how to structure your programs to make them really faster than any other VM can make them. the use case for that speed up your programs. Simple examples. So the root case behind that is some. Imagine you construct a you have a algorithm, which is taking in a lot of parameters, some configuration object, like expected speed, ratio. I don't know, a lot of configuration parameters. And